Neil, I've loved your work. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about taking on a project like this. You're known for making great movies with modest budgets, but this is obviously a much bigger project. I was wondering if you could talk about maybe some of the pluses and minuses of working on something that is a grander scale, and then if you guys want to talk about what Neil brought to this project that made it special in your own minds.
So now I'm making a modest movie with a great budget, right? What I liked about it was Veronica's book, obviously, and obviously for director, what's wonderful is try to create a new world, you know, a world that's set in the future and create all that visually. But really what I liked was that what was at the heart of it was the human element of this young woman's journey, which I felt like, yes, it's based on a young adult story, but I felt like it was a universal story about, you know, where do I belong? Who am I? You know, who am I loyal to? Am I loyal to my family? Am I loyal to myself? You know, what am I really willing to go out on a limb for? And I liked all those ideas, and I thought that they were in her book and really tightly tied to the action about what happens. And then I felt like it expanded out to something much larger, which was, you know, how do you keep a society together? You know, at the beginning, it seems like they figured it out. They've got this five-faction system, which is kind of a cool idea, and they seem to be living in peace and harmony because of it, and then it all starts to fall apart. And I liked how the character of Triss, you know, how she goes all through that. So, and I liked the fear landscapes. I thought they're really, really cool.
Can you talk a little bit about being the lead role, lead star of such a big-scale project, and also how is it like working with Miles again?
Working with Miles again?
Yeah.
That was awesome. Miles is great. Green screen acting is by far way more difficult than human interaction. So that was a big, big sort of learning lesson on this movie. It was really fun. I've never done a movie of this scale before with themes this big in a world that's completely different or somewhat different than the world we live in today. And so a lot of it was challenging for me, I found, because I had to sort of erase my preconceived notions of what I was used to acting in movies, you know, which is generally reacting off of somebody else, and sort of create a new world and adapt my style of artistry to the style that this movie sort of lent to, which was really exciting. And Neil created such, well, Veronica originally created such an amazing world, and then Neil visually brought it to fruition in a way that I could have never imagined it. And so it was really, we're so lucky to sort of be pieces in the puzzle of this new dystopian future.
I imagine in the life of a young actor, all of these sort of big franchise properties may come your way, your agents may send you out for all of them. Had you gone out for any of the other big young adult literary franchises, and what made Divergent the one you wanted? And have you talked to any of your colleagues who've also headlined these sort of big franchises?
I did audition for Hunger Games back in the day, and Jen Lawrence actually helped me with Divergent, because I still have yet to meet her, but I asked her sort of about her experience with Hunger Games and how her life has changed and sort of going from small independent movies to something as big as Hunger Games. And she gave me really beautiful advice, just sort of saying how much she appreciated it and how much it's changed her life for the positive, or in a positive ways, and she really kind of helped me on this journey. Initially,
I went for Star Wars, the new ones, as Chewbacca's son. it's an integral role, so cross fingers.
This question is partly for Veronica, and in your novel, you're talking about values like bravery, honesty, being intelligence, and stuff like that. And how does that come from your own faith and philosophy, and how do you bring that to life visually? Because it could be something that could be kind of stale in a movie. It's build big ideas like that.
Yeah, I've always thought of Divergent as a kind of indictment of myself, because the virtues are selected based on how I would form my personal utopia. You know, if I were arranging a utopia, it would be a world in which everyone holds themselves accountable and is responsible for their actions, and these are the virtues I would choose. And then the process of writing the book was one of seeing that I would just be like a terrible god of a universe. Just don't do it. Don't give me that responsibility. So, as you know, that's kind of where the world and the all of those virtues come from is just from a very personal place. And as for how to translate it visually, I didn't do that, so.
If you were put into a fear landscape, like, as you guys, what would be...
Like right show? Now?
Yeah.
This is a fear landscape, actually.
Oh. Yeah, this is a simulation.
You're right in our fear landscape.
Oh, no. I'm wearing no pants as well.
Yeah, but go on.
Yeah, just like if you as personally, like what would be in your fear landscape?
Lots of bugs. Like lots of bugs.
Theo, what are you afraid of?
I think you said the Theo.
Theo.
Hummus, probably, in some kind of way.
Who?
Hummus, you know what you say? Hummus, you say.
Thing? What?
Basically, various dips that you put pita bread in. Pita bread. Hummus. Sorry, my grandfather's
hummus,
Greek.
Hummus. H-U-M-M-U-S.
I'm getting really close to the mic. No, my grandfather's Greek, so he used to say hummus. So that's where I get that from. Anyway. Congratulations.
Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Like the fruit.
Shailene, what are you afraid of?
I think, you know, one of Triss's was
I'll be asking all the questions from now on.
She got pecked by crows. That's pretty terrifying.
Yeah.
I would not like that at all.
My mom picked the crows. Did you know that?
Did she?
I said, spiders or crows? And she said, crows. And
yeah.
That's how it happened.
I think that's worse than spiders in
a way. Yeah.
That's awful.
Ugh. Way creepier.
Yeah, no, I'm not into that idea.
You know, in the last panel, they talked about how you'll be giving up a lot of your privacy for the role, and you've addressed it here as well. And there'll be positives, but there's also be negatives being such a high-profile project. What do you think will make it worth it about this role?
I mean, I think that the whole, like, anonymity thing is a very interesting concept. But I think that if you lead the life that you want to live and you are the person that you want to be, then there's really not a lot to be afraid of, or there's really not a lot of negatives, because I think you can create a life outside of yourself that sort of this industry is able to infiltrate, but then you create a life inside of yourself that nobody really has access to. And so I'm just excited for it. I'm excited for the future. I know, Theo, you're very afraid. You're so fearful. Of what's to come.
I'm extremely scared, yeah. Every day I wake up very scared. No, I think, you know, you have to, doing a big, you know, it's definitely a question you have to really contemplate, and you have to be sure you're going to do it. But, you know, if you're entering something that already has a fan base and has people invested in it and has books that obviously Veronica wrote, and they're great pieces of work, I think as long as you put your everything into it and try and make a movie that you are proud of, then, you know, the rest hopefully will come with it, and people will be as proud of it as we are proud of it, you know, because we finished literally, you know, 2 days ago, so we're kind of very fresh off it, and we feel very proud of it and very excited for people to see in Hall H this piece of footage which you know, Neil and the guys have put together. Because, you know, I was saying to Shay before, when you're doing a movie, you know what you've done, and you know what your colleagues have done, and you've seen bits and bobs, but really, until you see something cut is when it's really gratifying, and you say, oh, okay, now I see it in the context of the world, and you can see that it's going to be a really strong piece of work.
Well done.
Yeah, what?
This is for Shailene. Did you read the book before, over here?
Oh, no, where are you?
Right here.
Oh, hi.
Did you read the book before you started shooting, and what inspiration were you able to take for your character from the novel, or did you stick strictly to the script?
I read the book. Yeah, I definitely read the book before. I read the book before there was a script that I read. And luckily for me, it was written from Trish's point of view. So Veronica kind of did a lot of the work for me.
Totally different work. Totally different.
Before scenes, I would go back to the book and sort of see what Veronica had put in there in Trish's mind and the mindset behind each scene. And that really helped me a lot get into the emotional stature of where Triss was in that particular place.
How is it to be back here now with the film?
Man, it's crazy, because 2 years ago I did like a very brief little press conference, and I was scared out of my mind. I was sitting at a table just like this, and it was just me, and I was like, okay, how's this gonna go? But this year it's just so exciting to, you know, have something to share with people and to have that something be so awesome, I think. Yeah, I'm really excited for everyone to see this footage, and I'm excited for them to get to talk to these wonderful people, and it's all been great.
One of the main things about the concept that jumps out to me is that in my high school, as in a lot of high schools, all the tables are sort of divided up at lunch tables, and the divergent idea kind of struck me as similar to the high school being divided up like that. What table did you sit at in high school?
What a question. My high school wasn't one of those like easily dividable high schools. I was a nerd, I guess. Yeah.
Lucky you.
Yeah, it's good. This is a great place to be a nerd. I mean, Comic-Con? Yeah, bring it on.
What is something that you guys admired about the characters you both played?
I had an affinity with the character from the very first time I read anything on it, because I liked, he was different to me because he had a very grounded, quiet sense of masculinity, which I don't think you see much these days, and it's kind of reminiscent of those, in my mind, his character, those old movie stars, I said to Neil, the kind of Paul Newmans, this strong sense of masculinity, but without having to show it, and with being watchful and intelligent, but also encompassing all those traits of someone with strength and a kind of common sense of, a strong sense of being, that was for me.
I really admire Triss's sense of selflessness. I know that she sort of grew up with that, and it was engraved into her at a very young age, but I think that that is a trait that we could use a lot more of in the world today, and I think that coupled with the bravery that she's sort of forced to call upon makes for a really profound, complex human, and I really found her admirable in that way.
My question is for Theo. Not many people have probably heard about you prior to getting this. You were the foreigner flirt from Downton who made a tragic end.
What's Downton?
So what was it like coming into this with, really, you weren't on anyone, at least fan-wise, radar for this character?
Wow, interesting question. It was good, actually, for me, because I came in late doors. They had been looking for a long time to kind of fulfill that spot, and they hadn't found anyone. And as soon as I kind of came in and I met Neil and I met Shay, it was a very natural fit, and it happened very quickly. And that is gratifying, because I kind of knew that they had invested in me and found something that they'd been looking for a long time, which is a good place to be in, because you feel safe and you feel gratified and wanted. And he's a tough character to find, I think, because he is young, but he's an old soul, and he has a lot of complexity. So it was good.
How true to the books is a movie to the book?
I think it's going to be very true to the book, actually. Obviously, a movie is a different beast than a book, and it's
Are there like going to be a few surprises for fans?
What's that?
Are there going to be a few fan, surprises for fans?
I think so. I think
four is only in two scenes.
Yeah.
So.
Don't say
that. I play a small chihuahua.
Oh.
Four, because I have 4 feet.
No, but I think that was the great challenge of making this movie, was to try to fit as much of the book into it, because there's so many characters in the book that are, that have their function in the book and that are kind of beloved, and so many great set pieces, and too many really to fit into a movie, but we really worked hard to squeeze them all in and to kind of come up with an idea for a movie that was, even more fast-paced than usual and more kind of denser than usual, with so many, there's three villains, and there's, she's got a whole set of, friends, and there's her relationship with her parents and a relationship with Janine Matthews, and with, it's real, there's a lot going on in the book, and there's going to be a lot going on in the movie, and that was the real, so it's very faithful to it. Obviously, certain things are kind of smoothed out or combined to make them, so there's sort of one kind of essential dramatic journey in the movie, whereas there might have been more kind of turns in the book, but it's pretty faithful.
I'm a big fan, actually, of your singing. So I know you have a band. Are you going to be doing any of that lately?
I thought you were about to ask me to sing.
In reference to Divergent. Do you do that in Divergent? Okay, thanks.
Yes, no, that is part of my... yes, I do, on the side, I like to do that. That is kind of something I've done since I was very young, and I did music at college, and that's part of my thing. So yeah, and it's a good way to kind of purge yourself of one kind of work sphere and dive into something else.
It's an a cappella group, right?
Yeah, a cappella hip hop, Euro house beats. I just dance naked in red hot pants, but it's kind of.
I was just curious, when you were writing the book and you were like taking part of this whole process, is there any particular scene in the movie that was so familiar to the book in the way that you imagined it? Like, is there something special that you just loved that they did with the movie?
The scene that felt the most familiar was the Ferris wheel scene, because it was the Ferris wheel that is in Chicago that I wrote about, that Ferris wheel. They were climbing that Ferris wheel on the ladder that I like researched to make sure it was there. And it was like, oh, this is exactly right. I mean, a lot of it felt very, very familiar because, as Neil said, I mean, it's very faithful. I was trying to think of like pivotal scenes that had been cut the other day, and I was like, I don't really think I can remember any. So, yeah.
Well, that you just finished filming literally just the other day. And it may be hard to choose, but was there a best day on set, and what was it?
My favorite day was the Ferris. Well, you know, there was a lot of good days, man, to be honest. But the Ferris wheel day was pretty special. It was a night shoot, and we climbed this Ferris wheel for probably 12 hours, 13 hours, 12 hours
yeah.
straight.
Yeah. From in the middle of the night.
In the middle of the night, and it was also the full moon, and it was the first super moon of the year, which I'm such a geek over.
And it was about 38 degrees out as well.
It was so beautiful, and we got to watch the moon go across. It was just a magical moment in life. And how often do you get to climb a Ferris wheel? You never do. So that was probably one of my favorite moments of life.
Wow, that's awesome. It was very special. Right. I'd say mine was the kind of climatic scene of the movie is when Four has been put under this serum and he's not himself, and Trist, you know, she comes to basically, you know, she comes to save the day, and then there's a fight scene between them, and then she essentially wakes him up through love. It sounds kind of But it was a very powerful scene, and you know, we were both sweating, and I had my hands around Tris, Shay's, I'm getting confused. They're so
neck.
Similar. Around her neck, and you know, there's this moment where we just connect, and it felt very real, and it's also a great way of adding emotionality to a big action set piece, and I think it's going to be a really beautiful part of the movie.